Hi, everybody. God bless you. I just wanted to get on here for just a few minutes and share something that was on my heart. And I was reading about it yesterday. I came across it as I was working on one of my chapters in my book. And I've had some time this morning, some thoughts that came across my heart, and I just wanted to share them with you. On Harrison Ministries on our YouTube, we finished a teaching. It was like 7 weeks long on communion. Communion right now is like my trumpet that I'm blowing because the Lord spoke to me the word communion. And then as I began to seek Him on it, He began to share with me more that communion was going to be a weapon of warfare during these times. And I can tell as sometimes as I'm telling people or I'm sharing my testimony or sharing some of the things that the Lord has told me, I can sometimes see this blank look like over people's face. And I get that. Listen, we do not, our carnal man does not want to listen. Our carnal man believes what we see. We believe what we hear. We believe what is been presented around us, but we cannot live by the carnal man. We have to step into the spirit. The Bible says we must know Him, must know Christ in spirit and in truth. I remember my father, he used to say, don't ever ask your flesh what it thinks because it's never going to agree with truth. And he was so right. And so communion is literally stripping away that carnal thinking. And the enemy, he is sly. He is tricky. He works so hard for generations after generation after generation, satisfying the act of communion. So many of us have taken a communion service. So many of us have participated in communion service. And I can't talk about how it affected you, but I remember for me, I can only tell on me, was we would do a communion service and then we would go on with the other activities in that service. And after the end of the Sunday morning service, we would go about our day and go about our week as normal as planned. And I never thought too much more about it. Now, maybe that's not you. Maybe you dwelt on how you felt, or maybe you dwelt. I'm talking about me, you know, and I'm not proud of that. I'm like, well, why didn't I consider seeking to go deeper in this communion? Because why would the Father have the Holy Spirit to inspire to put that part of the Lord's Supper into our Bible if He didn't mean for us to have a revelation of its truth? You know, the Bible is not a mistake, and it's not a coincidence, and it doesn't contradict itself. It is perfect in every which way. The most biblical minds will never unveil its full mystery. It takes the leading of the Holy Spirit to guide us, and I don't believe that the Holy Spirit just force feeds us the word either. I believe that we receive the word of God in the times and of our life. I'm going to receive from the word of God what I need. I know in my natural body, there'll be times where I will just crave something off the wall. I remember a few months back, I craved, get this, asparagus. Like, I craved it. And my husband, he works in nutrition, and he's a personal trainer. And he's like, well, there's some, then you're needing the vitamins that comes along with eating asparagus. Your body is telling you that. And so for 4 or 5 days, no matter what I ate, I had it with asparagus. And eventually that craving went away. And so we, just like our natural bodies, our spiritual bodies, our spiritual person needs to be fed the word of God, and it needs the word in which we are fitting. How can I say this? To the time that we're in. So seasons and times are so important. It's just like you wouldn't go out in a bikini and a bathing suit in the middle of winter, right? I hope you wouldn't. Maybe if you got one of those really, the hot tubs or something, but I think you get, in other words, you're not going to wear a fur coat in the middle of summer, right? So we do according to seasons. We do according to where we're at. And I believe that God has a word. I believe His Bible is endless. The mysteries, the revelations is endless. Why? Because I believe that He is. And so I love spending this time daily. I spend it daily. I've created a life in which I'm giving myself time to spend daily time with Him. And I encourage you to do the same. We're all busy. Listen, we all have families. We all have husbands and kids and houses. And I have been guilty of letting days and days go by. And then it hit me that I hadn't spent any time in the Word or in prayer and stuff like that. So I have scheduled it into my daily routine. And now, guess what? I would never go back to not having it. If you got 5 minutes, if you got 10 minutes, I promise that you do. You may have to set your alarm and get up 30 minutes earlier. Go to bed 30 minutes earlier so you can get up 30 minutes earlier so that you can spend time with Him. But there's a will, there's a way, right? I want to get to it. Part of that communion that I really enjoyed was the part when we were talking about when He said, "This do in remembrance of me." That word remembrance keeps coming up. It came up yesterday, and that's what I want to talk about today. I was reading out of 2 Peter chapter 3, and this is the last chapter. This is basically Peter's final words, so to speak. And if my book is almost finished, and I have a chapter in this book strictly dedicated to Peter based upon one of the most powerful open visions I ever had of him. And so I love to look at Peter's life. I can relate in a lot of ways, unfortunately. And so I wanted to look at this. But before I read to you out of 2 Peter, I want to go back over something that I wrote down a few weeks back about remembrance. The action of remembering something is a memory or a recollection of something. That's if you was to look up the word remembrance. The state of bearing in mind, the act of recalling something, or in mind a memory of a person or an event. The thing about it is we are made up of our soulless realm, our mind. We're fought in the mind, but this is also where the Holy Spirit ministers to us. The north gate of us, if you will, is the place in which that's the battlefield, basically. But it's also the place in which we are to renew. And we are to get transformed. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, it is the perfect, acceptable will of God that this takes place. So it makes sense, really, that this is the part in which the enemy will come to kill, steal, and destroy. I've said it time and time again. The enemy is not after your money. What is he going to do with your money? Right? The enemy is not after your marriage. He's not after your children. He is not after your body. When I get attacked by the enemy, I always get attacked in my body. And I've been in a warfare with pain in my body the last few years. And sometimes it's been chronic pain. But guess what? He's not after my body. He's not after my body. He is after what I believe. Because if he can get into here, if he can get my heart, if he can get my belief, then he's got my money, my marriage, my children, my body. He's got everything. So he is after what you believe. The battle is definitely in the mind. And so when he said in the communion teachings, "Do this, this do in remembrance of me," he was still going back, and Christ was saying, the power, life and death, of course, is in the tongue, but this authority in which the tongue speaks starts in the soulless realm or in the heart. The Bible says, what a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It's a belief. You are a self-proclaiming prophecy, and what you believe will become the truth. You will walk this out. And I say this constantly because I have to also be reminded. I assume that you too have to be reminded. But that was the definitions I just gave you was the basically your normal everyday definition of the word remembrance. But a biblical meaning of remembrance is awareness, to be aware. It means to realize, not just in the past, but it means also realize what your future is. It's not, remembrance is in the biblical sense, because God, listen, he can see everything. He doesn't want to have a remembrance of things in your past, but also he wants there to be a remembrance of what's in your future. He says, do not forget my benefits. So we want to be constantly reminded of his goodness, of his mercy, of his love. That's ahead of us, all of us, no matter where you find yourself at today, no matter what the battle is today, no matter how grim, no matter how dark, he wants you to remember him, because when we keep our eyes focused on him, then we see all that he is. He is our provision. He is our healer. He is our peace. He is all these things. Okay? So it says to be aware. Be aware and then act accordingly. The act accordingly is what we all need to work on. Sometimes we know what the word says, but we don't act upon it. We need to not only be aware of the word, we need to act upon it. It needs to be not only our truth. It's kind of like this. I am married to a man who constantly, ever since I've known him, and I'm talking about daily, he is constantly looking at nutrition, health, exercise, and the word. This man is constantly reading in the word, constantly. He lives a very scheduled, very disciplined. He's got that teacher anointing, just bam, 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 bam. I mean, he's got, I don't know how many alarms on his phone. Like, he does what he needs to do. Even if he sets an alarm on his phone, on his calendar, there's all these little markings of everything, and he has all these alarms that go off to remind him, to keep him on his day. Now, do I suggest you alarm everything? No, that's him. That's what he loves, and that's what works for him. You got to find your system, what works for you. And the things that he has these alarms to keep him throughout his day is important to him. My husband was bedridden for almost 5 years with a spinal injury. And so he knows firsthand what it means to not have good health. He knows what it's like to not be able to get up out of the bed. He knows what it's like to have to depend 100% on people to help you go to the bathroom and get dressed. Or he knows what it's like to want to go outside and you can't, because he's bedridden. So he has learned to value and to redeem his time in areas that maybe some of us have taken for granted. And in that time, that even that was the darkest of his life and the darkest of all of our family's life, it was actually what positioned him. And in that dark moment, he made a decision to remember Christ. He didn't look. He started remembering Christ. He started seeing himself walking. He started seeing Christ as the healer. He started seeing Christ as the provision. He didn't even know how he was going to provide for his family. How is he going to do that? He couldn't even sit in bed. He had to lay. He laid. And so when it says a biblical meaning of remembrance, it's not just an awareness of where you're at and where you've been and what has happened to you and woe is me. But it's in the dark times, communion is remembering the price in which Jesus paid to make a way of escape for you. Okay? And so in this biblical meaning, so he's saying, don't be just aware of your past, but be aware of the future. How can you prophesy God's plan for your life? How can you prophesy scripture into your future if you don't look at it through communion? Communion, I've said this, I'll say it again, is not crackers and grape juice. That is a natural demonstration. That's something that we do in the natural. That's something we do in the natural. But if we don't have an understanding, a grip on its spiritual meaning, then there will be no transformation. Revelation is what transforms us. The knowing of truth frees us. Not just truth, the knowing, the intimate exchange and sharing is what frees us. Communion is seeing and hearing God. Communion is when you read your word, it comes alive to you. Communion is not only when you read your word, it comes alive to you, but now that it's alive, you act upon it. The Father reveals to you who He is, and you respond and act accordingly because of who He is. This is communion. This is, listen, and I'm not saying this from no other arrogance or anything else. Out of all the things I've ever seen or heard the Lord tell me, I'm telling you, if you don't heed to the true communion teaching during these last days, I don't know how you're going to make it. I don't. When He said it is the tool, it is the weapon, it is the key. I believe that. I may not be on here teaching communion every day. I may only have the 7 videos plus this one. But I am literally looking for communion. And I'm seeing it all through the Word of God. I'm seeing it with spiritual eyes. Because that is what it is. But He's saying, be aware of your future. How can you be? He said, do this often in remembrance of me. Keep this door open between me and you, is what He's saying. I shared on my video of the remembrance. It was the neatest thing when I began to study in Hebrew, the word remembrance. It meant not only to be pure and to be clean, but it says to be male. And I thought, to be male. And immediately the Lord took me back to the scripture when He said, First Corinthians, when it says, let your women be silent. Paul was writing, let your women be silent. And most people preach that women are not to minister, they're not to teach in the church, they're to be silent. And they see that as an identity of a female sex, like sex identity, male, female. But that's not what that meant. He's not identifying the female, the woman. He's identifying the emotion. So he is saying, do not let your emotions minister through. We're not to minister through our emotions and our opinions, because they are like the sea. They're like the ocean. They're up and down. And we're to minister from a place of transform places, and places in which we have revelation and then we've been transformed by. And so I won't get into all that. But it meant it also meant weapon, which I thought was neat because he said communion was a weapon. It means weapon. It means it brings us to resurrection, spiritual completeness. It also says the Father's perfection. So that was just a really, really cool teaching on remembrance. But before I let you go, I want to pull out something that I was reading yesterday. It's 2 Peter chapter 3. And this is how it starts. I love this. Are you ready? It says, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds, your hearts, your soul, by way of remembrance. He's saying, I both want to make active. I want to bring an awareness. I want to awaken in you truth. Your righteousness, your pure minds. Remember, righteousness, we are but filthy rags, but we have opportunity to trade off our filthy rags for his righteousness. Righteousness is right living, right speaking, but right thinking, right doing. To be Christian is Christ-like, right? And so he's like, I want to make active. I want to raise up. I want to resurrect. I want to awaken the righteousness by the way of remembrance. Remembrance of what? Remembrance of his promises. Remembrance of who he is. Because guess what? Remember, I preached on this. Fruit calleth forth fruit. All through the Bible is a golden cord of reaping and sowing. And Christ was the perfect picture of this. He said, I do nothing. I say nothing. If you see me, you see the Father. Our lives needs to be an example that if you see me, you see the Father. I want my life to be an example of his supernatural power. I want my life to be an example of his love. Fruit calleth forth fruit. We should be known by our fruit. I want my heart, my life, my testimony. Now, you've heard people say, I don't want people to see me. I want them to see Christ. Well, there's only one way to do that. That's through communion. I mean, you can sing it. You can testify. It sounds beautiful. But until you put action behind it, I still see you. And we are filthy. We are nasty. Have you ever known? You know, there's people out here that won't go to church and they won't walk into a church building because they're like, those are the meanest people on the planet. Christian people. I'm not going in there. They talk about each other. I'm not going to go in there. I had a dear, dear friend. He was a doctor in Kentucky. And he was a Hindu, Indian man. Sweet, just loving, kind person. And we developed a friendship because I worked with him. And he said to me, you want to know why I don't serve your Jesus and I don't have your Bible? And I said, yes, I do. I do. I want to know why. And he said, because Christians don't follow it themselves. So why should I? That's what he said. That's what he said to me. He said, you guys don't do what it says. Which made me think, well, how would you know unless you've read it or you've been in it yourself? So there was a curiosity. Make a long story short, he at the end of things, he began to support our ministry. And he began to say, you know, if you ever take your, he called it my missions. If you ever take your missions to India, my family and would love to have you in our home over there. So anyway, but I'll never forget him saying that. And I didn't take offense. I allowed it to convict me. The spirit of offense will keep you from growing. The spirit of offense will keep you from hearing what the spirit of the Lord. And listen, if he can use a donkey, right? If he can speak through this and through that. He can speak through people that you would never dream to, that would speak to you, bring you to a place where you can now say, Lord, I repent for being out of communion with you. And I want to come back into relationship, intimacy, that sharing of exchange. I wanted to make sure that that's all I wanted to read, but I love that part when he says, I stir up your pure minds by the way of remembrance, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Knowing this verse, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking with their own lust. And lust doesn't mean just sexual things. It just means anything that you desire that is not of Christ. Okay, it's desire. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as that they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were old and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth which are now by the same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years as the one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works and therein shall be burned up. Seeing then all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being of fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall be melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Okay, you want to circle that part. Wherefore, beloved, he's talking to those with ears to hear, talking to those that are in communion here, okay? Those that are walking in remembrance. Seeing that the yoke look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. And account that the long suffering for our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written to you. He's like, listen, I suggest you understand the writings of Paul. It's about 14 books of the Bible, so I'd get to it, right? As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which some things hard to be understood, which they are all, which they are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. These are Peter's final words. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing you know these things before, beware lest you also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow. This is the last thing was written by Peter. Grow allow the Holy Spirit to reveal to you His truth, right? He says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord. Not just grace by itself, but in revelation, in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory, both now and forever. Amen? Amen. Hope you have a fantastic day. And I hope that you, if you haven't had the opportunity to go back and listen to some of the communion teachings, to go ahead and do that. And if they're about an hour or so long, you don't have to just sit and watch me, of course. There's nothing about me that's fancy. But you know what? I suggest maybe you should just throw some earbuds in, put it on the communion teaching, and as you're cleaning or as you're going about, or maybe put it in your car and listen to it. Let it get into your spirit, but don't take my word for it. Mm-mm. Don't ever take a preacher's word for it. You need to get into the Word of God yourself. It's the Holy Spirit that will lead and guide you, not Ronna Harrison, not Harrison Ministries. The Holy Spirit. If you hear me, somebody needs to hear me. If you cry out to Him with your whole being, just everything, with your whole heart, right? Lord, I want to know You. I want to know You. I want to understand You. I want to see You. I want the Word of God to be made tangible in my life. He will come, and He will saturate you. And that's what's going to take. That's what's going to take. If you're waiting for Sunday morning service and for your pastor to set you free in every area of your life, it's not that you won't receive from Him. It's not that you won't feel the presence of the Lord. I pray that you do in every service. But Sunday morning, Wednesday night, it's not enough. This is a lifestyle. It's not a little club or gym we visit once in a while. It is a lifestyle. It is being transformed by the renewing of your mind. It is the intimate, it's communion that sets us free. The Bible says the truth in which you know frees you. The truth in which you know frees you. That know in that scripture is communion. The intimate exchange, sharing, communicating between you and the Father. You seeing and hearing what the Word of the Lord has for you. Amen. God bless you. Have a great and powerful day.